Good afternoon. I would like to welcome you to the second session of the second day of FSED. This is a session on lambda calculus. We will have four talks in this session. But first of all, I would like to thank Naoki Kobayashi for chairing, for this very successful chairing of FSED, which provided this interesting program of invited speakers and contributed talks. Also, my thanks go to Alejandro Diaz-Caro and his team for organizing and for doing this great effort to make this virtual event successful with a lot of discussion rooms. But I think that we would really all like to be there in person, and maybe one day we will be. Okay, so let's start with the first talk. The first talk will be given by Axel Kerinek. This is a joint work with Giulio Manzonetto and Simone Ronchi della Rocca, and the title is Call by Value Again. The floor is yours.
And I will talk about Call by Value Again, a paper I have made with Giulio Manzonetto, with my PhD advisor. We are both from the Lipen in Paris, and we worked with Simona Ronchi della Rocca from Torino in Italia. This paper is about lambda calculus. Lambda calculus was introduced in the 30s by Church and Clini. It's a formal system central in logic and programming language theory. Is central because it's simple with a powerful syntax. In fact, it's the kernel of functional programming languages. We can consider terms of lambda calculus. We can consider those terms as programs, and we have a rewriting of term called a reduction, and we can see it as a step in the program. Some terms reach final forms, which can be reduced anymore. Those are called normal form, and we can see those normal forms such as results of programs. But not all terms reach normal forms. Some of them have infinite reduction, but they are still not meaningless because we can have programs leading to infinite run, but still producing new data and still being with a meaning. So for those terms without normal forms, we still want to understand them and their behavior. And for that, there is a huge need of approximation. Approximation theory has been studied a lot. And in the syntactic world, we can consider two sides. In one end, we have bomb trees. The idea is to enhance lambda terms with a new symbol, bottom. And bottom represents an undefined term. So from that, we have a natural notion of preorder by seeing that bottom is smaller than any lambda term. And so a lambda term with a subterm bottom is smaller than the same lambda term with another subterm instead of bottom. And we can define approximants. Approximants are normal forms of these terms in a Swiss bottom. And we can define approximants of a term by taking approximants closer and closer to its hypothetical normal form. So for a term M, we took all the N into which our term M reduces, and all the approximants closer, smaller than those N. And we define the bomb tree of a term as the supremum of its approximants. We can see it as a tree, potentially infinite. You have an example there. And the study of the term comes with the study of finite parts of the tree. This notion of bomb tree has been made by Barendrecht in the 80s and is really central. On the other hand, we have denotational models. Really well-known denotational models are filter models created in the 70s. The idea is to have an intersection type assignment system. So a set of rules to give types to terms. And here we have an operator which is idempotent, associative, and commutative. and we define the interpretation of a term as a set of types that can be assigned to this term in different environments. So a thing that we want when we have models is an approximation theorem. An approximation theorem says that if a term M has a type alpha in an environment gamma, this term has an approximant A with the same type alpha in same environment gamma. And this is really important. In fact, that means that the interpretation of a term is equal to the union of the interpretation of its approximants. And it's really a key point. There is some properties that we want to characterize. First of all, some definition. We say that a term is normalizing if it's reduced to a normal form, you know, a form that can't be reduced anymore. It's n-normalizing if it's reduced to some special form there called an n-normal form. And some terms lead to infinite reduction, and we want to approximate and understand those terms. A property that we want to characterize is solvability. We say that the term M is solvable if we can find a context into which plug our term in order to reduce to the identity. The identity is lambda x point x and is a fully defined result. In fact, if a term M is solvable for any new term N, we can find a random context in order to reduce M to this new term N. Traditionally, there are three ways of characterizing solvability. The first way is logically. In fact, we can define a suitable intersection type assignment system. And is this type assignment system, the solvable terms have some specific types called proper types. It's a result made by Barendrecht, Kopo, and Detsani in the 80s. The second way is semantically, but saying that the boundary of the term should be different than bottom, a result made by Barendrecht also in the 80s. And the last and third way is operationally, by saying that a term is being solvable is equivalent to this term being n-normalizing, and it's a result made by Wadsworth in the 70s. But you have seen the title. Here, I want to talk about call-by-value. I want to talk about call-by-value and not about the general lambda calculus. In fact, in lambda calculus, we have different reduction strategies. Those different reduction strategies correspond to different evaluation order of subprograms. The classical one is called by name, and it's when we evaluate first left subprograms. All the results I have presented before are in fact for call by name. But in this paper, we are interested in call by value. Call by value was introduced by Plotkin in 75, and the idea is to evaluate first arguments and then the body of the program. It's more efficient and closer to modern programming languages such as OCaml, but it's also more difficult and the theory is less studied than for call by name. In this paper, in this presentation, I will present a suitable model for call by value. So concretely, as always, we have terms. Terms can be variable, abstraction, or application. But here we have some specific terms. Those specific terms are values, which can be variable or abstraction. As always, we have a reduction. We reduce to the capture-free substitution of V by X in M, meaning that each occurrence of X in M not under the scope of a lambda is replaced by V. But here it's important to notice that the argument is a value and not a general term. So it's different from call by name when we can apply an abstraction to any term. And this leads to huge problems because we can have some stuck reduxes, which are premature normal forms. And this is really a huge problem in call by value. In order to solve this, in 2014, Carora and Guerrieri introduced new rule to sigma rules, which are permutation rules and allows to unlock stuck reduxes. those rules can be introduced without loss of generality because it doesn't alter the semantic, they doesn't alter the operational properties of the calculus. A variable term is still variable, same for being solvable or potentially variable. So let's talk about approximants for Kolbe value. As for Kolbe name, we introduce bottom. But here bottom represents an undefined value and not an undefined term. And when we define operator, we say that bottom is smaller than any value. So a term with the subterm bottom is smaller than the same term with the subterm any value instead of bottom. So for example, here, I can't say that bottom is smaller than omega, since omega isn't a value. We define approximants. Approximants are normal forms of term in length with bottom. And those are normal forms either for beta reduction, but also for sigma rules. Those are quite complicated, and we have two types of them. First one are called head approximants because they remind us n normal forms of Kolbe name. And second one are redex-like because they look like redexes, but they are still in normal forms. We can define approximants of term in the usual way by taking approximants closer and closer to the hypothetical normal form. So if a term m reduced to a term n, we're gonna take all the approximants smaller than n. And for some terms, this can be empty. For example, omega doesn't reduce to any value, so it doesn't have any approximants. The Baum tree is defined as usual as a supremum of approximants. And so for omega is undefined. And those notions are in fact really new in Kolbe value. Those results have been made by Manzonetto, Pagani, and myself in 2020. So this notion of Baum tree is really central in Kolbe name, but in Kolbe value is only the beginning. The model I will present enjoys the approximation theorem with respect to this notion of approximants. So we have a correspondence between types of terms and types of approximants. So it's really central and important. And now let's talk more in detail about models. In Kolbe name, we have a lot of interesting models. And by interesting, in fact, I mean fully abstract. A model is fully abstract if two terms having the same interpretation is equivalent to those two terms being observationally equivalent. And in Kolbe value, we don't have any fully abstract model. We only have some adequate models. In 2020, Manzonetto, Pagani, and Ronchi della Rocca introduce a new class of models for Kolbe value. Those models are presented as intersection type assignment systems. They enjoy adequacy, but they are not fully abstract. But in fact, they are closer to full abstraction than well-known models introduced by Erhard. So they are quite interesting. Here, I will focus on one of those models and present it, study it. So we start by defining types. So we start with a set of atomic types and we build types and multi-types. Multi-types represent intersection. They are of finite size and enjoy associativity, commutativity, but not idempotency. And for those of you who are familiar with Erhard's model, there are a few differences. Here, the intersection is only on the left, and empty set is the only idempotent element. In fact, empty set is quite a special element because it's both a type and a multi-type with different meanings. As a multi-type, it represents the multi-types containing a non-determinate amount of the single type empty set. And as a type, it's a special idempotent type. It's the only idempotent type. this model, we have a notion of equivalence between type, but here it's only the equality. But this change in other models of the class introduced by Manzoneto, Pagani, and Ronquillo-Arouk. Now we can take a look at the inference rules. The three first ones are quite common and self-explanatory, but this one in red is used to assign empty set to all values. And this one in red is used to collect several types in one single multi-types representing intersection. Our model is sound, meaning that two beta equivalent terms have the same interpretation, which is the thing that we want. And this model allows us to characterize some properties, both logically and semantically. Some definition. We say that the term M is valuable if there is a value into which our term reduces. And the term is potentially valuable if we can find a context in order to reduce to a value. Here, we have a theorem. We have that a term is valuable if and only if we can assign to this term the type empty set in some environment. And it's also equivalent to having bottom as an approximant. And being potentially valuable is equivalent to having some types in some context and to having some approximants. Because here we can have some terms without any approximants. For example, omega doesn't have any approximants. In order to characterize more properties, we find our notion of approximants. In fact, we take our subset of approximants and split it into two subsets, S and U. Notice that here in S, we have H, and this H comes from the previous notion of approximants. In both S and U, we have some head approximants and redex-like approximants. And we can look more in detail about U. U approximants are the one with bottom on the left, for example, bottom, or lambda x1 dot 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 xn dot bottom, or the redex-like with the lambda x's dot bottom on the left. And since this is a partition, approximants not of shape S, not of shape U, are of shape S. And this allows to characterize some properties. Remember, a term is solvable if we can find a context into which plug this term in order to reduce to the identity. And here we have a characterization of this. A term is solvable if and only if it has a proper proper type in some environment. A type is proper basically if it doesn't end with empty set. So being solvable is equivalent to having a proper type. And this is also equivalent to having an approximant of shape S. And since S and U form a partition, we have a direct corollary, saying that a term M is unsolvable if all its approximants are of shape U. We also have another nice corollary. The model induced by our type assignment system is not sensible, but semi-sensible. This means that this model does not equate a solvable and a non-solvable term, which is nice. But sadly, it does not equate all unsolvable terms. And since our model is presented as an intersection type assignment system, it's natural to wonder whether the inhabitation problem is decidable or not. The inhabitation problem is if given an environment and a type, we can find a term corresponding. The question is not just to know if there exists such a type, but to find it in an effective way. And this is not a trivial question, in fact, because it's undecidable for call by name intersection type system, a result made by Urzitzin in 1999. But for non-idempotent intersection is decidable by Bucchiarelli, Kastner, and Ranke in 2018. And in our case, we are in call by value and with only one idempotent element. So we can ask ourselves this question. So in order to solve it, we introduce an algorithm. This is a non-deterministic algorithm, and this doesn't find terms corresponding to a type and an environment, but minimal approximants for a type and an environment. The rules apply bottom-up, and IT there stands for the set of minimal approximants for an environment and a type, and IM is an auxiliary doing the same but for multi-types. As I said, this algorithm is non-deterministic, and the non-determinism comes from the two last rules, because you have to find a suitable decomposition of gamma, so there is a choice there. And this algorithm terminates. It terminates because for each one, a run corresponding to a minimal approximant, there is a decreasing measure bottom-up. And there is a bound in the number of runs because there is a bound in the number of minimal approximants for a type and an environment. We also have soundness and completeness due to the correspondence between types of terms and types of approximants. So to conclude, we have presented a model presented as an intersection type assignment system for call by value. This model is coherent with previous notion of approximants and boundaries. It's allowing to characterize semantically solvability. We have also refined the notion of approximants also in order to characterize solvability. And we have shown that the inhabitation problem is decidable for type assignment system. In the future, we want to extend those results to other models of the class introduced by Manzonetto, Pagani, and Rocky de la Rocca. And since those models have been constructed trying to follow continuous semantics and lifting, we think that there is new construction, and we want to study the categorical construction behind it. So thank you all for listening. I'm really happy to be there. This was my first participation at a conference. Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you, Axel. Thank you very much. So this was a very interesting talk, and we have some time for discussion and question and remarks and so on. So there is in chat, there is something. I have a warm up question, actually several of them, but let me start. Here you as approximants, do you consider Böhm trees? This is a kind of standard approach. Did you consider maybe other kinds of trees, such as Levi-Longo, Berarducci, and
we haven't for now, but maybe later.
Yeah, it seems that it could give some other insights as well. A thing is the values that are defined. So a value is a variable or a lambda abstraction. This is also somehow to say the classical definition, the usual definition, not the classical, but the usual definition. Mm-hmm. But also here you may play also with the variety of values. So maybe only a variable can be a value or an abstraction. This also can give different.
Okay. We haven't looked at it at all for now, but maybe I can try.
Yeah, so I think that that the approach has quite some potentials, and maybe you should really. I'm now aware that. Okay, yes, here we have a question from Delia Kessner. Can you compare with other approaches, other non-idempotent systems of call by value?
Actually, I maybe don't have strong knowledge about other non-idempotent system. So I can't really answer to that.
Yes, well, nowadays it's, I mean, till recently, intersection types are mainly where idempotent it was an idempotent structures, but now there is, as you mentioned, this result of
Bucarelli. We just only one idempotent element. Mm-hmm. While other approaches have more idempotency, but mm-hmm. I don't know a lot about mm-hmm. Comparison.
Yes. Okay, so let's thank Axel again. Thank you.
There is one hand raised.
I can't see that, but maybe you can unmute.
Yeah, sorry. Can you give some intuitions why the inhibition problem is decidable despite the idempotency of the empty multiset?
Inhibition problem is decidable. But basically, this algorithm works by finding minimal approximants. And we have a notion that I haven't presented there of minimal approximants corresponding to a shape of proof. So from that, we can come back to terms.
Because the point is that, I mean, since this element is idempotent, you don't know how many times you have to use this resource that is typed with an empty multiset. So how can you guess? I don't know. I mean, this is intuition.
In fact, we can find a bound in the number of minimal approximants. I don't know if you can see my things. Yeah. We have a bound corresponding to the size of we can have a bound on the number of approximants, of minimal approximants. So defining measures on types and environments. So we don't have an infinite number of one, even if we can choose the decomposition.
Mm. But the point is that you don't know how many times it's finite, but you don't know how. So I guess you have to bound this.
A bound.
Anyway, sorry. I guess now it's too technical, and we are.
Yes, I think that it
maybe
would be
we can discuss it offline later.
So. Yeah, to take it offline. Oh, yes, sorry. And to continue with the talks. Thank you again, and
Thank
for
you.
The discussion. Thanks.